Dear friends, it's a great joy for me to meet you once again through this program. And I want to talk to you today about the dynamics of the fast that pleases God. Dynamics of the fast that pleases God. To root my message in a particular verse, let us turn to Isaiah 58 chapter verses 6 to 8. Is not this the fast that I've chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. Is it not to share your bread to the hungry, and that you bring the poor that are cast out to your house, when you see the naked, that you cover him, and that you hide not yourself from your own flesh? Then shall your light break forth as the morning, and your health shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Dear friends, God commanded Isaiah to confront the people of Israel regarding their hypocrisy. The people of the promised land were living a hypocritical life. They had all the sacrificial practices, all the rituals were there, but they were not able to come to God with humility. What was the condition of the people of Israel? God said, "You seek me, delight to know my ways as if they are righteous, as if you are a righteous nation. You ask of the ordinances and justice. You take delight in approaching God." All these things are there. We may look at this bunch of people and say, they are so spiritual, but they were not. God was not in a position to answer their prayer. Why? They were not right before God. They say, "We fast, you do not see. We afflict our souls, you do not take knowledge." But they were having strife, debates, arguments. They wanted their voice to be heard. Self was there. They had only rituals in their life, but they were not able to understand the meaning of fasting and prayer. They were under bondage of wickedness. They have carrying heavy burdens in their lives, sins and problems. They were under oppression. They were under the yoke of the evil one. Many Christians in these days live like that. Outwardly, they may go to church, pray, do all those things, but still they are not able to pray as God would expect them to pray. They may fast. Sometimes they feel it is hunger strike. They want to go and charge against God and say, "Oh God, I want this, I want that." Fasting prayer is not a hunger strike. So, dear friends, what is needed is understand the dynamics of real fast and prayer. There was a woman who was not really a saved person. She had a small child, 3.5-year-old girl, and the girl was sick. This woman had never habit of prayer. She never used to pray. But when the little child was sick, she went to God and said, "Oh God, if you are a real God, if you are a powerful God, heal my daughter." Well, even that arrogant prayer God heard. The child was healed. The child began to grow. That was the last time that this woman, this mother, prayed for her little daughter. She grew up with all the affluence of this world. And when she was in her teens, she became pregnant because of wrong relationship and she committed suicide. The point is, many people do not know the meaning of real prayer and real fasting and prayer. The dynamics of fast that pleases God, I want to deal with this in three sections. Section 1, the spiritual aspect, let the oppressed go free. Section 2, undo the heavy burdens, how to take care of others' burdens and help them. Section 3, blessings of such a fast. Section 1, spiritual aspect, let the oppressed go free. This is, you find it in verse 6. Is not this the fast that I've chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, that you break every yoke. Dear friends, when we really pray as we ought to pray, we would definitely be able to do what God is expecting us to do. Now, people are bound by sin and evil, and under the bondage of wickedness, there are many believers who are not able to come out of certain evil habits in their lives. Some are not delivered, and they do not know why they are in that particular condition. They love sin. They love sin, and they are not willing to come out of those bondages. When people are in such a situation, what is to be done? We are expected to loosen their bonds. What to do? The first point is, learn to pray in the Spirit. St. Paul, when he wrote Romans 8, chapter 26 to 27, he says, "Likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our infirmities. For we do not know how to pray as we ought to pray. He prays for the saints, believers, with groanings that cannot be uttered." Sometimes, you know, people feel mouthing words and saying something before God is prayer. No. Prayer must be done with the help of the Holy Spirit. Unless the Holy Spirit is in us, we would not be in a position to pray as we ought to pray. St. Paul himself says, Spirit helps us in our infirmities because we did not know how to pray. Even he did not know how to pray. The Holy Spirit should be able to pray a prayer by the will of God, in the will of God, with groanings that cannot be uttered. So, dear friends, if we have to pray a prayer that is effective, we must have the Holy Spirit in us. James, in his epistle, writes, 5th chapter, 14 to 16, he says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Effective prayer. Effectual fervent prayer means energio in Greek. That means it's power. A person who is praying without much of a warmth in him cannot pray such prayers. A person who is really born again, a person who knows what he is doing, then there is real burden in that prayer. So, effectual fervency is there. In such prayer, there is deliverance. When people pray such prayer, there is deliverance. So, the effectual fervent prayer of righteous man avails much. So, when we pray for one another, we'll definitely be a blessing for others. And then, when we see a person who is sinning a sin not unto death, we have to pray. We read it in 1 John 5th chapter 16 to 17. There it says, if you see a person who is sinning a sin not unto death, pray for him, God shall give him life. What a beautiful point there. When we see somebody who is away from God, who is continuing in sin, we pray for them. Sincerely, when we pray for them, definitely God will give him life. Now, this type of prayer will not come automatically. So, when we learn to pray as we ought to pray, we can definitely be a blessing for others to be delivered from their bondages. During the civil war in USA, one soldier was found to be coming back from a jungle near the enemy's fort, enemy's area. So this soldier was caught by the others and was taken before the tribunal. The top person said, where were you on that particular evening, in a particular time? He said, I went out to pray. And he said, how do we know that you went out to pray? And that you did not go to the enemies to squeal about our own position. And he sincerely said, no, sir, I went out to pray. And the top person there in the tribunal, you know, if he is found guilty, they could shoot him. The top person in the tribunal said, okay, if you really went out to pray, now kneel down and pray. This man knelt down and prayed, oh God, you know that I went out to pray. I'm not able to prove myself. I'm not able to explain to these people how guiltless I am. You help me, O Lord. A short prayer. After the prayer was over, the top person said, come on, get up and go. You are freed. You are acquitted. You are a praying person. So, dear friends, unless we know how to pray, we can never help other people. So, if we want to deliver the other people, if you want to deliver other people from the bondages, you should know how to pray. Second point is, you must know how to pronounce the word with faith. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, God will give you a word that you should say. And when you pronounce that word, bondages shall be broken. Isaiah 45, 11 to 12 says, thus says the Lord, the Holy One of Israel and his Maker, ask of me things to come concerning my sons, and concerning the work of my hands, command me. Not that we command God, but when the Spirit of God moves us to say something, when we say, it happens. So pronouncement of word of God by faith is important. When you pray for your children, when you pray for your family members, when you pray for the people in your own church, you can use this, provided you are a person who is a praying person. When you are a praying person, and when the Spirit of God gives you a word, when you pronounce it, it will definitely be fulfilled. The bondages shall be broken, or some blessings will come for which you are praying about. There was a believer who was sitting in his office doing his mundane work. Suddenly, before his mind, there came a vision. He saw his own son floundering in water. There was a flood in a river. He was trying to swim, and floating trees were also there. He saw that he was trying to swim lying on his face. Suddenly a thought was put into his mind. He began to tell God, oh God, tell my son to swim backwards. Tell my son to lie on his back and swim backwards. So saying, he came out of his office, he being run towards a particular direction. He came to a river. The river was in spate, it was flooded, and many people were standing on the bank of the river. And as he approached a particular point, he saw his son, who was drenched in water, coming out of the river. And he said, "Sonny, what happened?" And the son said, "Daddy, I was crossing the river. Suddenly there was a big flood. And I was caught in the flood. I did not know what to do. I was trying to swim on my lying on my face. I was so tired. Suddenly I heard a word telling, 'Come on, son, swim backwards.' I began to swim backwards. I was able to come near the shore." I tell you, friends, if you're a praying person, God can give you the right word to talk to people in the right season. Your word in season. The right word that you speak is like a golden apple in a silver plate. You can tell the word of God with God's power. Okay, friends, so to break the bondages, you must be able to pray with all your heart. Second, pronounce God's word as God wants you to say. You know, many people say something and say it is prophecy from God. No, I'm not telling that. A word from God that is able to perform the purpose for which God sends that word. The third point is, bring down the anointing that will break the yoke. Bring down the anointing that will break the yoke. Jesus said, "If a person is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink. And as the scripture says, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water." And in Proverbs it is said, "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." You know, after we receive the anointing, it's not simply saying a few words and tongues. It is more than that. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is in us. Holy Spirit, God is in us. So we have to keep our heart with all diligence. The river of life will flow from our own hearts. So, dear friends, if you have to break the bondages in the life of other people, you must be a praying person. And you must know God's word. When God speaks to you, you must be able to listen to it and pronounce that word. And then the anointing will come. After the word, the anointing will come. Anointing will not come away from you. Anointing works in and through you. This is God's methodology. Years back when I was in Bombay, I was 25 or 26 years old. When I was in Bombay all alone in a flat preparing for a ministry there, early morning the Lord spoke to me and said, "I will work out a great work in and through you." It's not you are somewhere there and God is working out of you. He works in and through you. The anointing comes into you when you keep your heart clean. When you keep your heart with all diligence, and out of you the river of life shall flow. So this is the way to break down the power of darkness. When you pray for somebody in this pattern, definitely they will be delivered. Now we must understand that we have to keep our testimony clean. Our testimony is very important. Satan and his cohorts, satanic powers are everywhere. They try to bring people into bondage. So when we try to go and deliver people from bondage, our conscience must be clean. So the word of God says in Revelation 12:11, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death." You will have no value for your own life when you are standing for the Lord. And you can overcome Satan by two things. By the blood of the Lamb, Jesus' blood is available in the word of God, and your testimony must be right. Not that I got saved many years ago. How am I now? I must understand where I am. If my conscience is clean, if my testimony is clean, definitely we can say no to evil powers. We can just break the spell. We can chase the evil spirits. So, dear friends, we must understand that we have to deal with the sinful nature that we have in our hearts. There was a pilot who was flying a small aircraft. It's a single-seater aircraft. As he was flying high, he was in the cockpit, suddenly heard some nibbling noise coming from the engine. He felt that it may be a rat that has gone into the engine. The rat is going to nibble some wires and all. There may be some short circuit and the flight will be in jeopardy. He will be in danger. So he did not know what to do. He was a single person flying the plane. And suddenly he had an idea. He put on oxygen mask, took the flight to a very high level where the oxygen content outside is very rare, very, very less. And as he flew very high, and for some time, after some time, the noise stopped. When he landed on the, when he landed in the airport, he was able to see a dead rat in the engine area. I tell you, friends, when sin is trying to molest us, sin principle is in our hearts. when it is time to stifle us, when it is time to bring us into again some temptation, some bondage, we must fly high. By the Holy Spirit, they that wait upon it shall, they that wait upon the Lord shall mount up like eagles. So when we pray with all our heart, when we spend time in the presence of the Lord, we will be lifted up to a very higher plane. And there, the sinful nature will not molest us. So, if there is some problem in our personal life, Satan would know about it. Evil powers would know about it. So, if you have to break the bondages in the life of other people, you must be a praying person. You must be able to pronounce God's word as God gives to you. And also, you'll have to bring the anointing. And to be on the safer side, keep your testimony clean. Then you can definitely break the bondage. So, dear friends, we must be able to understand these dynamics. This is real fast. This is what God tells. Many years ago, when I was here in Chennai, staying in a house, there was a young man and his wife with two children staying at the back of our house. And this man used to have some sort of nervous breakdown. And one day he was brought to me for prayer. He did not know about the Lord Jesus Christ, though he was a Christian. He used to take his wife sometimes, push her into a corner, go on pummeling her and beating her for 2 hours. And she'll go on talking back. She would try to lash back by her mouth. This was going on. She was very lean. And when this young man was brought to me, I gave him a Bible. I spoke to him about the Lord Jesus Christ, prayed over him. After 2 days, he came to me. He was changed. He came to me and said, "Uncle, I am not able to beat my wife." He did not say, "I'm not beating my wife." He said, "I'm not able to beat my wife." Though he tries to beat his wife, he couldn't beat his wife. The bondages are broken. He was totally delivered. So, dear friends, we can have this power of the Lord. And this is how the fast must be. So, God says, fasting and prayer means you have to break the bondages. Section 2, undo the heavy burdens. Galatians 6, 2 and 5 says, "Bear one another's burden, so fulfill the law of Christ." And also he says, "For every man shall bear his own burden." 2 points are there, appears to be contradicting one another. First point is, bear one another's burden. Now, all of us have our own burdens to bear. Certain burdens are too heavy for us. We cannot bear it on our own. We must be able to get some help from other people. If you are a person who is led by the Holy Spirit, you will have sufficient understanding to know the burden of the other person. This brother is suffering, this family is suffering, they cannot bear it alone. I must go and give a shoulder. At the same time, let every man bear his own burden. We have our own responsibilities to do. That we cannot expect others to come and do. Let us do our responsibilities, our tasks we must do. At the same time, when we go through a problem that is beyond our capacity to bear, we have to have believers, brothers and sisters who can share our burden. So, second point of real fast that God likes is undo the heavy burdens. Now, are we trying to do that? For that to happen, you must have discerning spirit. Many people are careful about themselves. They pray for themselves, pray for their own well-being, pray for their own prosperity. They have no burden for other people. But when we interact with other people, maybe on a road, when you walk by, there may be a person who is sitting there hungry. Do you have a heart to give some money? Do you have a heart to help such people? If you are a person with love, if you are a person with the discerning spirit, you will definitely be able to help such people. There are many who are in suffering, many who have burdens. Many are having burdens that are not, they are not able to bear it. If you are a believer, if you are a person who is able to have real prayer life and a heart of love, you will definitely understand when other person is in need. You will reach out to the people and help one another. Nobody has become poor by giving. Nobody has become rich by not giving. We must understand that. Many people are full of greediness. Love of money is root of all evil. So to undo heavy burdens, when you come across people in your own church, in your own family, you must have a heart of understanding to know and discern what is the need of the other people. One day in Hindustan Bible College, where I was working as an academic dean for 8 years. There was a young man who was keeping his hands at the back. And I was sitting at the back. I found that he had no watch. And the Spirit of God told me, get a watch for him. Well, I took some money, got him a Titan watch. And then the Lord told me that I should get 2 shirts for him. I tell you, friends, if your heart is open, you can undo the heavy burdens. God will guide you what to do and to whom it should be done. And when you do something, there's always a blessing. Blessing means not that you'll have to get more. As far as I'm concerned, there is joy in giving. When you give to somebody, there is joy in giving. That is what I long for. Undo the heavy burdens. Undo the heavy burdens. And then the section third is the blessings of such a fast. Now, dear friends, when you're able to live in the presence of God, break the bondages in the lives of other people, then you will have heart to help other people undo heavy burdens. Definitely, you'll be a person who will receive blessings from the Lord. So what are the blessings such a fast can bring to you? Your light shall break forth as the morning. Your health shall spring forth speedily. Your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. You shall call and the Lord shall answer, "Here am I." What a beautiful point. You know, many people cry, they pray. They are not able to get an answer from the Lord. Somewhere down there, there is a barrier. But when you are able to understand the dynamics of this fast that God is happy about, then you will be able to call upon Him and God is able to help you. He will hear your prayer. The Lord shall guide you continuously. Sometimes, you know, we walk in the path of God for some time and we deviate. We get into problem. Years back when I came to know the Lord told me and said, when you turn to the right hand or when you turn to the left hand, you shall hear a word from behind you telling, this is the way, walk in it. I tell you, friends, we are to walk with the earshot of God's voice, earshot of Jesus' voice. He is a shepherd. He said, my sheep hear my voice. When we hear the voice of God, we will be able to walk along with Him. So the Lord shall guide you continually, and He shall satisfy your soul in drought and make your bones fat. You know, when there are problems, spiritual drought may be there, but in your heart, you will have all the grace that you need. You shall be like a watered garden and a living and a spring of life. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water. And the people who are of you shall build fallen places, build broken places. The point is, when you follow the Lord in this pattern, your own children and others whom you have been helping in the spiritual life, they shall build other people's lives. This is how the ministry of God should be built. You shall raise up foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the paths to dwell in. Then you shall delight yourself in the Lord. He will cause you to ride upon the high places of the earth. The mouth of the Lord has spoken it. I tell you, friends, this is not my word. God has spoken to you this day. In conclusion, let me tell you the same verses again. Is not this the fast that you have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness and to undo heavy burdens and to let the oppressed go free and that you break every yoke in your personal life, in your family, and when you do ministry, you must be in a position to break every yoke. It's not a single person's work, it is a collective work. Is it not to share your bread to the hungry and to bring poor into your own house to help them? When you see the naked, that you cover him, that you hide not yourself from your own flesh, then shall your light break forth as the morning and your health shall spring forth speedily. What God wants to work in and through you, He will accomplish in and through you. So, dear friends, it is imperative that we understand the dynamics of this fast that pleases God. So we must be able to break all the bondages, and also we must be able to undo heavy burdens, help one another, and then all these blessings shall be ours. When I began my ministry, came for full-time ministry when I was 25 years old, I was in Ilgris. I used to go to the estates and preach God's word, and I used to go to a particular estate called Hooker. In that particular estate, in a teacher's house, the meeting will be conducted. And one young man came. He was a tall young man who had completed his SSLC, but he was sick. His legs became like big legs, like elephantiasis, as if he had elephantiasis. And he was mentally little deranged. He used to move from one place to other, begging. He used to stand before the shrines and ask for some bread. Somebody brought him and he came and sat in the meeting in which I used to preach. Once a month, I used to go there and preach God's word. This boy began to hear God's word. I never laid my hand upon him to pray. He was totally transformed. His legs became all right. Mentally, he became right. And he became to, his mother tongue is Kannada. He used to read God's word. And somebody offered him a New Testament, Kannada New Testament. He began to hear, read God's word. His whole life was changed. And his family is from a non-Christian background, okay? And what happened was, his family had a small patch of potato garden. So when the potatoes are ripe, they used to have a little watchman will be there to take care of them, lest some wild elephants will come and eat away the potatoes. So this boy was asked to be take care of the garden one day. And there was a small thatched roof shed, and a bed was there. This boy was there sleeping. He used to sleep there. One day, he had a small oil lamp there. He kept his Bible, New Testament, on the pillow. He went out. Something happened and the oil lamp fell down and the whole hut was on fire. Everybody in that village came, and this boy came running. His heart was palpitating because his Bible would be burnt. When he came back, he saw a miracle. The roof had collapsed, the cart was on fire, pillow was on fire, the Bible was not burnt. All the people in that estate came and saw this little miracle. He took the Bible. I tell you, friends, people began to understand that this boy who was following Jesus had become a great blessing for others. He got enrolled in the army and as a home guard, and he got married. He is well settled. I tell you, friends, the word of God can do that. Undo heavy burdens. And the word of God is powerful. What God wants us to do is, let us cultivate this prayer, this real fasting and prayer that God wants. Shall we look to God in prayer? Our lovely Heavenly Father, help us to have a heart that will long to be used by Thee, O God. Help us to fast and pray, a fast that is welcomed by Your own heart, O Lord, a fast that is good before Your own eyes, O God, to break all the bondages, to undo the heavy burdens, and also, Lord, to help one another so that we will be led by You. We will become a blessing for others, and our own children, our own progeny will be able to build God's kingdom. Guide all these dear friends who heard Your word today. Let every person, let every family cultivate real prayer life and also involve in real fasting and prayer so that You would be in a position to use them mightily, O God. I give You all the glory. Let me have the joy in serving You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Dear friends, I'm happy I could talk to you today about the dynamics of real fast, and I persuade you to follow these precepts so that you would be blessed by God in your own life and ministry. May the Lord bless you.